from the Congress last September. So I think that these double standards must act, must end on that, and then that is how they can work it out on issues if they have to do that, you know.
On that very point,
they agreed with me on that.
Okay,
we agree with your prognosis on these issues.
I think, yes, we can see that there's a talk about Bill Clinton becoming the presidential envoy, the former president Bill Clinton, yeah, and also, this is a great job being done right now, but still there are two issues that I would like to deeply focus on. Recently, the president's visit to China and our government stock, which has been going with China for two more nuclear plants. There was news coming in from United States, and United States is opposing that deal between Pakistan and China for nuclear agreement. If you see not the perception, but exact logical results of the nuclear involvement, India is more involved than in Pakistan, except that our role was very much on the televisions every day. There are a lot of things that has been, especially the results that we are seeing in India, that some extremists are Indian army who are trying to do different things, and all those things which are being proven that they are also in India's relationships. Why does America still stands up after signing a nuclear deal with United with India, claiming that China should not provide nuclear? We are already nuclear power, but still they are against providing energy needs nuclear power plants to Pakistan.
I think that this is an unacceptable double standard on the part of the United States and U.S. policymakers. When on the one hand they are willing to look the other way and even violate their own law, especially the 1978 Symington Amendment and the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. Uh-huh. By having an agreement with India, which is a declared nuclear weapon state, which is not a signatory to the NPT, while conversely, at the same time, concurrently, they do not want Pakistan and China, and Pakistan went nuclear after India did, to have the same agreement which they have done with the Indians. So this is a clear case of double standards, and in my view, this also goes to show that this Indo-US nuclear accord is not about nuclear energy at all, because nuclear energy only counts only for less than 5% of India's energy needs. It's more about geopolitics. It's more about grooming India to take on China.
Okay. On the second point that I would like to talk about is the Prime Minister Yousuf Reza Gilani, in one of his speeches, he said that when Obama will come into the presidency and he will be the elected president of the United States, the drone attacks on Pakistan will stop. Some people are saying it's a government-American deal already being done. Like New York Times reported this, and all other big American newspapers are also claiming that this is a deal which is going on. The Pakistani government will just keep on demonstrating and will say that we protest, and America will keep on doing it. Obama also said in his presidential debate speeches against McCain that we will attack Pakistan. We will send our armies into Pakistan, and now we see that there are more forces being built up against Pakistan's tribal belt border in Afghanistan. Do you think this policy is a threat to Pakistan in the near future, or do you think how should Pakistan and how will Pakistan deal with it? You being a man who is being very greatly respected in foreign policy of Pakistan, how do you see it?
Well, first of all, you just alluded to that. What you've said, I want to just give you a success on that count. On 4th of November, 2008, the Washington Post carried an op-ed article by David Ignatius, and it said clearly that there was a secret understanding between Pakistan and the United States, pursuant to the visit of Mr. Zardari to Washington in September 2008, whereby Pakistan would look the other way and just protest and allow American attacks on its territory. And this statement or this story was reaffirmed by the New York Times on the 16th of November 2008 in a byline story which is carried. Mm-hmm. So I think the government of Pakistan needs to clarify its position on that, whether it is acquiesced by choice, by understanding, by agreement to the American violation of Pakistan's territorial integrity and Pakistan's sovereignty. So that is the main thing. Secondly, I think Mr. Obama made some statements on Afghanistan and Pakistan, which in my view were quite naive, because sending more troops to Afghanistan or using more force against Pakistan is not the answer. That is counterproductive, because they've used force in Iraq, they've used force in Afghanistan, it's not worked. They have to have a different approach, and they have to be very clear, because then the people of Pakistan will be legitimate in asking whether the U.S. is friend or foe. If we are being treated like a country which is at the receiving end of American attacks. So those attacks must cease, and we must raise our voice. And I've already proposed that we should attempt a delegation of Muslim leaders, maybe Pakistan, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Malaysia, Indonesia, to Washington and to the UN Security Council, saying that, look here, this is unacceptable. Already the so-called war on terror has failed because it has become an unwinnable war without end. And even a man like Karzai is now protesting and saying that America should give a timeline for the ending of its occupation of Afghanistan
Let me interrupt you here. Like, Karzai gave a statement about a few days back, and he said that NATO and U.S. forces are creating a parallel government in Afghanistan. Now, and he also talks about bringing Mullah Omar into the talks. He also talks about, either you talk with Mullah Omar or you throw me out of the government, you know. These are such things which for a Pakistani, for a Pakistani who's a normal, everyday, routine Pakistani, these things are very confusing. How is international politics working? What is the future of my country? How things are going to work out? Should I depend upon my politicians? What should I do? You know, what is the hope for a young man who stands on the street of Peshawar or Islamabad or Lahore or Quetta, and he says, where am I looking?
There's a lot of dynamism, there's a lot of zing, there's a lot of energy in the people of Pakistan, in the civil society of Pakistan, in the middle classes of Pakistan, in the society of Pakistan as a whole, which I've just mentioned to you, whether it's the media revolution, whether it's the advancement in education, women's rights, the activism which you can find. The people of Pakistan have become self-starters. But what is happening is there's no synchronization between what the society is moving forward at a faster pace than the political structures of Pakistan or the leadership of Pakistan, which is still traditional, which is more or less at a standstill, and they're not in step with the people of Pakistan. So we are an important country. We matter. The country has made tremendous progress in sectors which I've just mentioned. What has happened? Our main crisis is our crisis of leadership. The leadership is doing politics of business as usual. They are not giving a new hope and direction to the people of Pakistan. And I think that there has to be also the moral courage to speak the truth with your own people, with the United States, with others, and also a moral direction to the people. Otherwise, the feeling is that, you know, anything goes. If you are corrupt, if you have got your hand in the cookie jar, if you can commit any crime, you can get away with it just because you are got money or you've got power. That has to change. And I think that process is already underway. In my view, public opinion is far advanced than most of our traditional politicians, and they are being left behind. But this is a process which is underway, and it will take some more time to mature.
Thank you very much, Mushaz and Sayyid Saab. I totally understand you're a very busy schedule, but, you know, since the youth of Pakistan have got this only opportunity to ask a few questions, if you don't mind, I'll take just a little more time of yours. I know we've already been about 5-10 minutes up, but... Sure. When I see, as a Pakistani, my army chief says we will stand up against any person who invades our country. When I see my defense minister, he says we cannot stand up against these people. We cannot stand against... What is the solution? In my mind or in anybody's mind, the question that arises is, ki agar hum khade honge, hum Amerika ke khilaaf kya jang kar sakte hain? Hum is extreme pe bhi nahi jana chahte, because we are a peaceful nation and we believe in peace. Aur hum... किसी गैर कसूरवार बंदे को मारना भी नहीं चाहते. हम किसी कबायल अपने कबायली इलाकों में जाकर अपने लोगों पर बमबारी भी नहीं करना चाहते. हाउ व्हाट इज द एग्जैक्ट सॉल्यूशन दैट यू सी एज अ पॉलिटिशियन ऑफ पाकिस्तान, एज अ फॉरेन पॉलिसी एनालिस्ट, एज अ पर्सन हु हैज अ ग्रेट सेइंग इन एवरीथिंग?
आई फील दैट सबसे बड़ा मसला खान साहब है कि खौफ का खात्मा. वी हैव टू एलिमिनेट फियर फ्रॉम द माइंड्स ऑफ आवर रूलर्स. मोस्ट ऑफ द मुस्लिम रूलर्स आर वीक नीड. They fear their own people, they fear Al-Qaeda, they fear America, and because of that fear, they are unable to rise to the occasion or even speak the truth. Well, I'll give you one example. The other day, the Prime Minister of Pakistan said we cannot, and the Defense Minister, as you said rightly, said we cannot do anything about these attacks. Day before yesterday, if you remember, our Air Force Chief of Pakistan, Air Chief Marshal Tanveer Mahmood, said that we have the capability.